advocating for women's rights. That's our discussion this evening on Talk with Gaetano. Welcome back to the show, and thank you so much indeed. My name is Gaetano Kagwa. With me in the studio, we have Jacqueline Asiimwe, like I said, lawyer and women activist. And we'll go to part two of our conversation. Jacqueline, you mentioned before we went into the break something in regards to expectations of women in marriages. Mm-hmm. What I can get, what I can't get in that union. And we have the domestic bill, which has been bogged down in government, in parliament, for years and years and years, because it touches on a very sensitive area, I think. You would think by now it would be passed. Mm-hmm. But there's a fear that I think of culture and tradition being eroded by this bill, because women must get this, and then they can do this, and they can get that. It's going to cause problems. As a woman activist, how does that make you feel?
I think, in part, the narrative that it was a problem, I think, is largely media, male media at that. So maybe we'll not go there. That will be a conversation for another day. Because what we did do is first explain that this was a government bill. The fact of the matter is, we have a constitution that says in one of its articles, I believe it's 31, that all women and men of 18 years have the right to marry and found a family, and shall have equal rights at marriage, during marriage, and at its dissolution. A constitution gives you bare bones. What the parliament does through the legislature is then give flesh to those bare bones. Mm-hmm. So the marriage and divorce bill was the flesh to those bare bones. But in that attempt, like I said, I think the narrative and the conversation was sensationalized. And yet,
by male media.
Back by a largely male media, because the media is male dominated. But if we go back to what the constitution says, all it was saying was, so at marriage, what do we look at? Are they of sound mind? Are they able to consent to marrying each other? How do we address the issue of bride price that is part of our culture? And the bill said may, because we know even without the domestic relations bill, some parents have in fact started giving their daughters without requiring bride price. So in fact, I think custom and tradition have moved far beyond what the bill says. So that was that. Then during marriage, what can we delineate as rights for men and women in this union? There's, you're going to have sex with each other, right? So how do we define that? You're going to probably get property together. How do we define whose rights are what in that space? You're probably going to have children together. How do we, in marriage? Then sometimes, unfortunately, marriages don't last. Sometimes they fall apart. So when that happens, what happens? So it was delineating what the Constitution says about equal rights of both at, during, and at dissolution.
Jacqueline, you make it sound very easy.
It is not.
It isn't, Jacqueline. You make it sound easy. But there are salient points there. It's issues. If it was that easy, I mean, for goodness sakes, Uganda has a female parliament speaker.
Mm-hmm. And she did try to push. I remember even the Uganda Women Parliamentarians Association did try to push. I remember I, along with several others, were invited, not once, not twice, several times to talk to small, you know, caucuses of MPs, large ones. I mean, she tried, but...
Not only that, Uganda had a female vice president.
It doesn't matter when push comes to shove. I mean, the vice president was long ago. When push comes to, and at the time, even Speaker Sekandi, as he then was, also at some point, you know, led us to believe that before his term was over, before it went to Rebecca, that the bill would be passed. And unfortunately, the last day that Parliament sat that day, there was no quorum. So, of course, without quorum, they couldn't pass the bill. But, you know, they've several... Both the Rebecca and the Honorable Sekandi have led us to believe, and have actually, you know, there have been motions in Parliament that it's going to, and then it doesn't. But it's as bare and simple as that. In the meantime, people get married every day. I mean,
people get divorced every day.
The New Vision has run several stories, not once, not twice, about how people are not only duped into the wrong marriages. I mean, people stay together and think they are married, or celebrate marriages at the wrong place, which are not licensed. So those are the things that are in the bill, you know, that simply say, at marriage, are you sure you're doing the right thing? Are you sure you've contracted what would be called a legal marriage in Uganda?
Do you see this bill ever becoming law? Just very quickly,
Maybe in your lifetime?
When you're president?
Because I think it takes political will, and I think there was a time and place that women had political will all the way to the highest office, and I think that was when we had very many gains in terms of the law, in terms of positions, in terms of, you know, all these things that we aspire for in the public. But I think many other interests have come on board, and I think they have sort of subsumed, you know, women's rights, and so.
Okay. Do you think?
But it's a slow, you know, it's a slow fight.
From what I'm hearing, Jacqueline, you feel in your heart that women should get absolute equal inheritance rights.
I think so. Why not?
Were men created equal to women? And I'm playing to play devil's advocate here. I'm just trying to make people,
why are we going the creation story? Because for all intents and purposes, again, legally speaking, Uganda is a secular country. And the same constitution that calls us a secular country also says we are equal and there shall be no discrimination on the basis of sex, meaning that we shall both be treated the same, whether it is in property, whether it is at school, whether it is in inheritance, whether it is, we shall be treated the same. At the same time, provides for affirmative action where we need to catch up with the race because we've been left behind for so long.
I see women in power, women in positions in Uganda that I really makes me say they have for lack of a better word, and with all due respect, they have arrived. They are in positions of power, be it political, be it private companies, they're sitting on boards. And I mean,
But these are the ones you see and they are here. Be not deceived, be not deceived. Kampala is not Uganda. And I think a lot of this happens here or in the various few centers that we have and can name off our fingertips, but that is not Uganda. Like I said, that is not my aunt in Kambuga who is still struggling with my uncle just because my grandpa decided to leave her land and he's protesting that, you know. So we mustn't assume Kampala and what we see is all over Uganda.
But if I'm the father and I've decided I'm going to leave the land to my son,
yes,
that is my prerogative.
But if the man believes, no, but how do you give a land to your daughter? And so for him, that's the basis of fighting his sister. So, and that's, I mean, that happens a lot of the times. If you go to the Attorney General's chambers and just sit there and listen to the cases he listens to every day, those are the fights that we have.
Do you feel then perhaps that justice has not been done when it comes to women under all of these different challenges? Is justice being done? Is it being delayed? I mean, do you see justice? I don't know how to phrase the question.
Formal justice, I mean, is slow. And I think when the NRM came to government, I think what they tried to do was also demystify not just the gun, but justice, and say that, no, at your local level, you can deal with some of these things, and hence the LC courts, deal with the things that are petty, and you can, you know, like how we used to, I think, settle cases back in the day. Because, unfortunately, and I'm a lawyer, and it saddens me no end, our formal procedures and processes are long, they are sometimes corrupt, it's a lot of money, and not everyone has that money or that time to go through these processes. And there's such a backlog in our courts, and we don't have enough judicial officers. I mean, there are several problems to address in formal justice. So if we could strengthen the informal spaces, and I think that's what, you know, people working around legal aid are doing, people working to encourage, you know, cultural courts, people working to encourage how communities can solve their cases, but understanding that the dispensation has changed, men and women now have equal rights, so you can't throw a widow off her land, you know, you need to listen to her case as well, you can't not educate your girl child, you can't not feed your girl children, you can't, you know, those kinds of things have to be done.
Okay, you've got the educational system in Uganda that we have, UPE, blah, blah, blah. In terms of education and support when it comes to women who have been abused, let's talk about abuse, for example. What support and education must we give to those women who are abused? I mean, because you have abuse taking place on a daily basis.
Of course, yeah. On an hourly, minutely, minute by minute.
Thank you very much, exactly. Yeah. You know, when you call authorities, I mean, nothing seems to happen. you know, a woman has been, you know, for lack of a better word, been hit around or, you know, smacked around or...
I think we still have a long journey to walk around making violence against women taboo. Because for now it is largely accepted. I mean, some sections frown upon it, but generally speaking, you know, no one is going to flip or, you know, work will not stop because a woman was beaten, which is sad. And so, and this is one of the battles we've fought long and hard, you know, to speak with police, to speak with courts, to speak with doctors. If a woman comes, you, she's clearly been bruised and battered, but she's telling you she fell off this chair and fell down.
And she will even sometimes go, correct me if I'm wrong, she'll even go as far as saying, he hits me because he what? He loves me.
Yes, because that's what we are socialized to believe. You know, so I go in there or, you know, statements like, you know, that's part of the wear and tear of marriage. Go in and, you know, tewari bufumbo butaina.
Guma.
Guma, yes. And so in fact, when I was working in UONET, one of the things we did was to talk to the Senga Association here in Buganda to say, you're one of those that, you know, do premarital counseling and even, you know, postmarital counseling. So what is your conversation around domestic violence? Do you tell people, the women guma, or do you, what options do you give them? Because they can report the case, they can, you know, no woman, no man should live in a violent relationship. That said, though, there are not many options out there. And what we have tried as women's organizations, supported by government, is shelters. But still our shelters are few and far between. They can only take very few women. So we still need to find a way to make it socially unacceptable. I think once it's socially unacceptable and frowned upon, there'll be less and less of those cases, I think. So it's just the work to de-socialize people against violence against women.
And when you say de-socialize, it's not only about de-socializing it
and re-socialize with men,
but
the right values.
With the right values. But it's also women can be a... Do you find that even women are a sort of like a stumbling block or an obstacle in your work? Or you find it more so the case for it being men?
I wouldn't say a stumbling block. I think we are all socialized in the same space. I mean, my mother will grow my brothers and my sisters, so what she tells us will be the same thing. And that's why we spoke to Sengas, that's why we speak to these cultural institutions that incubate for us our cultures, our values, our norms that we pass on generation after generation to say, can we have a different conversation? If girls used not to go to school, now they do. If we used to throw girls who get pregnant off the cliff and now we don't, you know, society changes. Maybe now when we used to beat our women and it was okay, maybe now it shouldn't be okay, and this is why. Because when you beat a woman, this is what you're doing wrong.
I mean, it's very interesting. We live in how do they say that word?
Patriarchal
society. I've always had a problem with that. We live in a patriarchal society, and it's not about to change anytime soon. But you know, men will always feel as if it's a threat against being a man. I am the man. I am the head of the family. I am the one who provides. And yes, women have
come. So we need to have conversations about masculinity. What does it mean? And does it improve you when you have under you, if you want to be over them, people who are sad, who are miserable, who are scared, who are frightened, who are battered, who are endangered? Does that make you a man? And I think that the de-socialization that I was saying is going back to that conversation about what does it mean now to be a man? If that was the picture then, do we cling to it? What parts of it were good? Because we're not also throwing away everything, but what parts of it were good and esteemed the man in the right way? And what parts now should we discard and maybe do different?
So it's
that's why I have a conversation with my boys that we do not hit women, right? No, daddy doesn't hit me. I do not expect any of us will hit our wives.
We've got about 1 minute left.
Yes.
Is it a redefinition of a man's role and a redefinition of a woman's role to get us to where we want to be?
And redefinition of society, yes. Because the society that in which we live must be able to uphold this redefinition of man and woman.
Jacqueline Asiimwe, short but definitely very sweet as far as the conversation is concerned.
Thank you.
I wish you nothing but the best of work. And I for one, you know, I believe women, in fact, women, you have more power than you know. You have so much power over us men.
I think we know. We just let you know that we don't know. So we're duping you.
You're duping us. Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Jacqueline Asiimwe, for coming on the show.
My show says
Bongatano as my signature move as I end.
And then I say.
Then you can say, Kale guy, kankubonge. I don't know.
Okay, for old women, what do we say?
Listen, thank you so much indeed. As a man growing up, as a young boy growing up, I think we are indoctrinated into a mindset that perhaps is not good for society when you look down on a woman. It's important that, you know, you work side by side, you live side by side in a marriage, even outside of marriages, we're a community. And women today have a lot to say and a lot to offer. And by squashing them or putting them aside or treating them in a certain way, doesn't help you, makes you look like a batterer, makes you look, you know, like a bad person. So men out over there, love your women, encourage your women, your daughters, your sisters, your mothers, you know, and fight for them no matter what, like Jacqueline is doing. I think that's enough talk for now. We shall be back again tomorrow on the show. Until then, have a great evening.